There is a land in Africa, mysterious and steeped in ancient traditions, a land of contrasts and extremes. It has some of Africa's highest mountains and the lowest place in the Rift Valley. For 2 weeks, we traveled by air, road and boat to explore the northern and western part of this vast country, to visit its important historical and prehistorical sites that spent more than 2.5 millennia. In the absence of a city center, Addis Ababa feels more like a large village. Coffee originated in Ethiopia's Kaffa region. They serve the world's best coffee. Gold jewelry is sold by weight, a temptation few women could resist. The National Museum of Ethiopia is home to the world-famous Lucy, a 3.5 million-year-old hominid, an important link in the evolutionary chain.
Welcome.
We were met by Dr. Behane Afso, Ethiopia's leading paleoanthropologist, who gave us an exclusive behind-the-scenes tour of his research laboratory.
In the same place, in the Afar, a little higher, we found another species of the same genus. Genus is called Ardipithecus, and the species is called Ramidus. And that is 4.4 million years old. Ramidus is known now from lots of specimens, especially the skeleton of this species, representing from head to toe. And we know more about the biology of this species, and the result of the study will be published, you know, very soon.
Francis Thackeray, who is director now of the Institute of Human Evolution at Pitt, he gave me a whole lot of casts from different South African fossils. That's robust.
That's robust.
That's Mrs. Bless, famous Mrs. Bless, which set the whole thing going in 1930.
The question remains. Is Ethiopia or South Africa, in actual fact, the cradle of humankind? Another important find in Ethiopia's Afar region was one of the oldest Homo sapiens sapiens, the 160,000-year-old Hertor. Although the knowledge of human evolution has expanded since the discovery of Lucy in 1974, she remains a vital link of our evolutionary history. At the time of our visit, the original Lucy was on tour in America, and we only saw a cast of her. High up at Entonto, above the future Addis Ababa, Emperor Menelik II, as King of Sheba, established his residence in 1881. His hilltop palace still stands today. A plain building of clay, beautifully thatched with hand-tooled wooden floors. The top story consisted of a bedroom which had a curtained-off reception area. By bringing many regions under central control, he restored Ethiopia's greatness. Dignitaries awaited their turn for an audience in the nearby small building. The bigger dwelling was used for banquets and feasts. Close by is the still functional Church of Miriam, where he was crowned. In 1886, he moved his residence down into the valley near a hot spring. Around it flourished the new capital of Addis Ababa. Traditional music and food brought our first day in Ethiopia to a close. Yeah. A pancake-shaped sponge-like substance called injera, made of fermented teff, is used to scoop up the various tasty dishes. Today is a very important religious holiday. There must have been close to 500,000 people here to celebrate the Maskal festival, the finding of the true cross. Legend has it that the cross upon which Christ was crucified was discovered in the year 326 by Empress Helen, mother of Constantine the Great. To find it, she prayed for help and was directed by the smoke of an incense burner to where the cross was buried. It is claimed that a fragment of the cross is kept at Gishon Miriam, one of Ethiopia's oldest monasteries. A two-hour flight via Gondar took us to Aksum. Here, the Maskal festival was still in progress. Aksum is the oldest city in Ethiopia and was the capital of the historic Aksumite Empire that came into existence around 300 BC. Archaeological monuments are evidence of its long history, most famous of which are the stele. They are carved out of single pieces of stone, depicting several stories, complete with windows and symbolic beam ends. At the base, a false door with lock and knocker is carved. The 26-meter-high stele on the left was looted by Mussolini during World War II and taken to Rome. It was only returned in 2005 after much public demand. Once standing 33 meters high and weighing about 500 tons, this one is thought to be the largest piece of stone ever quarried and erected in the ancient world. Recently, some chambers were discovered beneath its base. Nice try! All around Aksum one finds relics of this once great civilization, which had its own coinage and the only written language in Africa.
apostate language, that's Ge'ez.
These memorial stones, inscribed in Ge'ez, Sabaean, and Greek, describe the military campaigns of King Ezana in the 4th century. His conversion to Christianity led to the establishment of the Orthodox Church. The Axumites traded far and wide with the Roman, Greek, Syrian, and Indian empires. Strange that of all the important civilizations, the Axumite kingdom is the least well known. The exquisite masonry work at the tombs of the Axumite kings Caleb and Gabra Maskal of the 6th century can easily compete with the more recent Inca civilizations in South America.
See there the main rock, like the Tigray rock in churches. So, but the idea was back before Christianity. From the idea
of... Together we stand, divided we fall. Come on now, people, let's get on the ball and work together. Come on, let's work together. Now, people. Because together we will stand, every boy, every girl, and man. Get down.
After a while, we abandoned the road repairs and decided to walk the remaining distance to the Stele Quarry and a beautifully engraved lioness on the hillside. According to legend, Axum was the capital of the legendary queen Sheba. These ruins are believed to be the remnants of her palace and the nearby stele field her resting place. Mei Shum was apparently Queen Sheba's bath and is still Axum's main source of drinking water. In Axum is the holiest Christian sanctuary in Ethiopia, the building that houses the most famous religious artifact, the supposedly original ark which contained the tablets on which Moses wrote the Ten Commandments. An armed guard ensured that the whole compound remained off-limits to women. It is said that Queen Sheba's son Menelik went to Jerusalem to see his father, King Solomon. On his return to Ethiopia, he brought with him the Ark of the Covenant. Behind this curtain is the inner sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, where a copy of the Ark is being kept. The 17th century church of four animals is normally closed to the public.
Is it his favorite church and also the closest one? So
every inch of the walls and ceiling is covered with a tapestry of paintings. This church was definitely more interesting than the nearby modern one built by Haile Selassie in time for the visit of Queen Elizabeth II. The highlights, though, were Bianca's beautiful rendition of Agnus Dei and a century-old Bible, handwritten and painted, that still remains in daily use. Drinking coffee is a traditional ceremony where coffee beans are roasted and pounded before being brewed and strained through horsehair. Early next morning, we made our way to the temple of Yeha. Whilst driving through this beautiful mountainous landscape, we were reminded that the Eritrean border is a mere 70 kilometers away and that the relationship between the two countries has yet to improve after the border war only 10 years ago. Little is known of the pre-Aksum kingdom of Saba that extended from Ethiopia across the Red Sea into Arabia. One of the most important settlements at the time was Yeha, the site of this huge 2,500-year-old temple. The precise workmanship of the finely dressed stone blocks point to a highly advanced civilization. In the vicinity was a treasure house so small that we had to take turns to see the carved stones from pagan times, as well as early religious manuscripts handwritten and painted on parchment.
It's a zoological museum. We haven't been there to take pictures of the manuscripts, each page. And also they stayed in Addis Ababa for a long time doing that. Nowadays, if you check their website, here museums, but later the people who are working there, skilled people.
The visit to the local market was interesting. However, we preferred to have our lunch in a nearby restaurant. It was in the granite hills around Adwa where Emperor Menelik II defeated the Italian army in 1896. Ethiopia may have been invaded, but claims to be the only country in Africa never to be colonized. The Church of Abba Garima and the adjacent monastery were again off limits to women.
You already read about the story there? And the
no, you're not allowed to look. You're not allowed to look.
There was again a treasure house of religious artifacts.
It was a lot of education going in.
This book, apparently from the 8th century, is possibly the oldest known manuscript in Ethiopia.
You see?
Early morning, we left Aksum in 4x4s and headed south towards the Simien Mountains. Along the road are still reminders of the civil war that raged from 1974 to 1991, fighting the communist regime in Addis Abeba. This Eritrean refugee camp is evidence that the Horn of Africa still remains volatile. A tortuous drive took us higher and higher, crossing deep river valleys and negotiating hairpin bends up numerous passes, some over 3,000 meters high. Whilst the flat tire was changed, we had the opportunity to observe the local wildlife. The Simien Mountains are one of the major highlands of Africa, with at least a dozen peaks reaching 4,000 meters. The highest at 4,620 meters is Ras Tashen, Africa's fourth highest peak. High up the mountains at the park, we stopped to collect permits for the national park and also picked up our guard and guide. Then we were off to the Simien Lodge, the highest hotel in Africa at 3,260 meters. It took 12 torturous hours to cover the 300 kilometers from Aksum. Tired and shaken through, we reached the Simien National Park just before sunset. We awoke to a crisp and clear new day. Whilst the guards were soaking up the warm morning sun, an endemic thick-billed raven scavenged nearby. We set out on a memorable hike in search of the Gelada baboons. We walked over grassy hills through forests of the tree-like Erica albora, decorated with soft gray moss. True to habit, the Geladas overnight on rocky cliffs in the ravines and in the morning descend to the grasslands to forage. They ignored us completely. Too soon we had to leave the Geladas, which are endemic to the highlands of Ethiopia, to return to the park, where we again had to have two flat tires fixed. Repairs the African way, but it works. From here it was only a short stretch to Gondar. You could be forgiven to think that you are somewhere in Europe. There are 7 medieval castles within a royal enclosure. The city of Gondar became the capital of Emperor Facilidas in 1636. He gave orders for the building of a castle which seems to have been constructed with the help of an Indian craftsman. Subsequent emperors all built their castles within this royal enclosure. For 2 centuries, Gondar remained Ethiopia's capital and the economic, cultural and political center of the country. This unassuming church of Debra Berham Selassie in Gondar is one of Ethiopia's best known. The spaces between the beams of the ceiling are covered with paintings of wide-eyed angels, all different from each other. It is a short drive from Gondar to the shores of Lake Tana. Driving through the countryside, it seems little has changed since early times. A refreshing cup of strong and sweet Ethiopian coffee was welcome before we embarked at Gorgora on the northern shore of Lake Tana. After a hectic week filled with new sights and sounds, it was a welcome relief to relax and have time to reflect on the rich experiences. Lake Tana, the largest lake in Ethiopia, is considered to be the source of the Blue Nile. The British explorer James Bruce is credited with the discovery of the lake in 1770. However, it was already known to the ancient Greek and Egyptians, and the Portuguese were already there in the 15th century.
The fact that I'm even standing near this guy is a no-no, because he is an Austrian, which means he stole the northern part of Italy and claimed it for himself.
Okay. One, two, three.
Goebbels had only one left wall. Hitler had two, but they were small. Himmler had something similar, but Mussolini had no balls at all.
There are few things the Italians and Austrians agree on, and this was one of them. The lake is dotted with small wooded islands, many of which are occupied by monasteries dating back to the 14th century, most of them off limits to women. One of the few that allowed women to visit was Assur Miriam. A short walk through indigenous forest led us to a circular church with thatched roof. Massive hand-carved doors cut from a single tree gave way to the inner sanctuary. The pictures from ceiling to floor offer a revealing glimpse into the Orthodox times of the Old Testament.
There are guards. No one can go in. Not allowed for anywho. Yeah.
Here, painting, sir, painting.
There are cultural things. Animals, when priests start for them with incense.
Here, like in every church, St. George guards the Holy of Holies by slaying the dragon.
The crown.
Stored in a nearby house were crowns of previous emperors and priceless books from the 14th century.
Salam! We come in friendship.
Tankwas, boats made of papyrus reeds, ply the waters as they did in ancient times. They are identical to the ones depicted in the tombs of the pharaohs. The Blue Nile exits Lake Tana near Dahir Bar.
It's quite a lot of water.
A short flight across the Ethiopian highland took us to Lalibela, a remarkable place famous for its rock-hewn churches. Long before the sun rises, the call to prayer echoes around the hills. And the pilgrims were out already in full force. Around the 10th century, a new line of rulers, known as the Sakwe dynasty, gained power. This marked the end of the Aksum Empire. The most famous of the Sakwe rulers was King Lalibela in the 11th century. At that time, Islamic rulers to the east closed the route to Jerusalem for the many pilgrims. So King Lalibela decided to create his own Jerusalem. He arranged the excavation of these houses of worship safe from prying eyes of the plundering and hostile Islam warlords. The churches are still places of active worship 800 years after they were built. Each of the churches has a resident monk as well as a copy of the Ark of the Covenant. A complex labyrinth of tunnels and narrow passages connect most of the churches.
Just go slower at the front there, please.
There's no hole down there for this. Is there?
Yeah.
Can't see it.
I think it's dirt.
We were going to close it.
I heard you guys.
They are different from most ordinary churches as they have been cut in one piece out of solid volcanic rock.
That building, it was also funded by European Union and UNESCO also built the other.
What a beautiful setting for Bianca and Fiona. There are two clusters of churches containing in all 14 places of worship.
Thank you.
The sacred rituals and archaic ceremonies of one of the oldest Christian churches open a window on the authentic world of the Old Testament.
Here we have one very interesting church.
Are there other prophets or saints?
The gem amongst Lalibela's churches is Bet George's. Freestanding and excavated below ground level in a sunken courtyard, it stands 15 meters tall. Entrance is gained by a passage with its opening hidden some distance away. After its outside was carved out of solid rock, the inside of the church was hollowed out. Almost unbelievable, but the sermon is still in progress late afternoon. Were it not for the famous churches, Lalibela would just be another rural town. There is very little tourist infrastructure, and tourist traps that feature so predominantly in our consumer society are conspicuous by their absence. Farmers and traders from far and wide congregate at the weekly market offering their wares. As the day ends, women prepare supper on open fires in front of their houses. Today is National Flag Day and all the donkeys are in their finest, displaying the Lion of Ethiopia. National Flag Day. In the hills above Lalibela is Neakutu Le'ab, a church built into a cave. Once again, a priest in typical robes displaying church regalia, silver crosses, handwritten and painted manuscripts, and a crown encrusted with jewels. One holy man and all his precious stuff seems to have been safe from thieves for centuries. Here we said goodbye to the main group, which flew back to Addis Abeba. 8 of us headed off in 2 4x4s to the Afar region in search of Lucy's birthplace in the Rift Valley. A rough road took us past verdant lush pastures, reminiscent of the European Alps. Only the cowbells were missing. Down in the Rift Valley, the dusty and noisy town of Voltia was our first stop. We stayed in the best place in town, the prestigious Lal Hotel. Although the bank was closed, Anna's charm helped to get money changed with the help of a security guard. Then we were off for a refreshing cold beer. We couldn't believe our eyes when we saw this Italian truck next to the road. It must have been left behind when their invasion ended in 1943.
Look at the money.
Not everybody has the privilege of driving an original Viberti. Today is D-Day, the day we are going to visit the Lucy site. All excited, we made an early start. As we travel further down the Rift Valley towards the Danakil Desert, the landscape becomes more arid. Few tourists ever find their way in this remote corner of Ethiopia. There were a few roadside villages. Here at Chifra, we were quite a curiosity. After inspecting the kitchen, we decided that coffee seemed to be the best option. This is Afar country, home of the semi-nomadic tribe, known for its fierce independence and ferocity towards strangers. You see hardly a man without his traditional weapon, the AK-47.
Oh, fantastic.
It was reassuring to have Daniel, our guide, and our two drivers with us.
Hello.
In this one-horse town of Eloya, we stopped to have lunch and collected our guide and our guard to take us to the Lucy site. After a quick check of our cars, some lunch and declining the offer of chat, we set off into the desert. The track in the dry scrub or just barren sand was often forking off in different directions. This elicited sometimes heated discussions by our Kalashnikov carrying guards, which were already in a stupefied state from chewing chat. We struck it lucky. It was midday and 40 degrees in the shade when we reached the camp of a group of American paleontologists that had arrived the previous week. Professor Bill Kimball from Arizona State University and his crew, surrounded by heavily armed guards, were as amazed to see a group of unexpected tourists. We were welcomed with a refreshing cold drink and then given an overview of the work currently in progress.
And the site is justifiably famous for its discoveries because at the time that Lucy was found in the 70s, the fossil evidence from this site was the oldest record of human evolution in the world. There was no well-dated evidence of human evolution prior to 3 million years at that time, other than Lucy. So it put, in many ways, Ethiopia on the map as far as paleoanthropology is concerned.
The field camp, which was situated near the Awash River, was fully self-contained, including a water purification plant and accommodation and kitchen for approximately 50 people, including 30 local staff. The field laboratory was fitted out with the latest technology.
So now the students are cleaning them and getting them ready to catalog. And basically, this year we're doing something different because we have barcodes for everything. So they get an individual ID, and then the students, once they identify them, whatever it is, they'll take it over to Chris over there, who will then put it in the catalog and make sure the mapping points are okay.
We were assured that when they leave in a month's time, there will not be a trace left behind. A harrowing drive, mostly in darkness, got us to Lucia. Lying on the Addis Djibouti main road, there is no doubt that this pit stop is for truck drivers and not tourists. By the time we got up in the morning, the beds in the driveway were already empty. A hearty breakfast was enjoyed at one of the truck stops. Then we headed south on the Addis Djibouti Highway. These semi-permanent structures are similar to the Maikis houses of the Nama in the Richtersveld. Although not legal, people eke out a living by selling charcoal and wood at the expense of the sparse vegetation. The Djibouti to Addis Abeba railway line, built in 1902, has not been in use for decades and has fallen into disrepair. No wonder the road takes a heavy hammering. The Avash River cascades over some falls in the Avash National Park before flowing through the Danakil Desert and into a lake on the border to Djibouti. From here we headed east through the highlands to Hadar. Once again, we stayed at a top-notch hotel that even had hot water for a few hours every day. Unfortunately, that didn't help much as the showerhead was completely clogged up. Until 1887, infidels were forbidden to enter the walled city of Hadar. Many Muslims consider it the fourth holy city after Mecca, Medina and Jerusalem. Here, chewing chat, a mildly narcotic plant, is a common pastime. The effect is clearly visible. Away from the hustle and bustle of the marketplaces, it is easy to get lost in a maze of quiet lanes. There you can still find traditional Hara houses, beautifully decorated and maintained.
Condisce anni per quanto riguarda l'Italia.
Come stare?
Adesso vecchio.
How are you?
No. Here.
During the Ottoman Empire, Constantinople was kept clean by hordes of stray dogs. Here, that was done by hyenas. Just outside the city wall, you can still find the hyena men feeding them every evening. Not a job for the faint-hearted. Although predominantly Muslim, there is ample evidence of religious and cultural tolerance. A sudden tropical downpour was reason enough to seek shelter in a nearby coffee house. As soon as the rain stopped, the marketplace sprang back to life again. It seems Bianca and Margaret are starting to run out of cash.
I'm a signal. Give me pen.
A short, harrowing drive in a minibus took us to Tire Dava. The 100-year-old railway station that once saw trains going from Djibouti to Addis Ababa is a stark reminder of better times. A short flight took us back to Addis Ababa. Arriving there felt like a time warp. This trendy coffee house could be found in any metropolis worldwide. Yet just next door, in a small storeroom, we were confronted by another Ethiopia.
As the harp of King David of Israel, you know, and it's a sacred instrument, and it serves the Ethiopian Orthodox Christianity.
Is it being played in church as well?
Well, when you say in church, it is not like doing in the mass, but in the church compound, when there are religious festivals, you play this instrument. You accompany when this tabot or the Ark of Covenant comes out in a yearly celebration or during the time of Epiphany.
Ethiopia is one of the poorest countries in the world, yet welcoming and open, and full of mysticism and ancient history that makes this country so memorable.